Hello, and welcome back to Laser Propulsion. I hope that you've had a very good break and are ready now for part number 5, laser ablative propulsion. Laser ablation, this means you take a very short laser pulse, and this pulse is capable to ablate a bit of the surface of a propellant. And to understand this, I got this short experiment for you to give you an impression of the order of magnitude in which this happens. So I take this bottle, it's about 1 liter, and if I take this bottle in this way, with a very small cap, and let it drop down on my feet, I'm pretty sure that this will hurt. So, let's now summarize what would happen if I really let this bottle drop down on my foot. Taking some numbers, the mass of the bottle is 400 grams, the impact area is 2.6 centimeters in diameter, and we have an altitude for dropping the bottle of 1.3 meters, which converts then from potential energy into kinetic energy. This finally yields an energy density on impact, dropping on my foot, of 1 joule per square centimeters. So in laser ablation, we have a pulsed interaction process, and it's somehow similar that we have an impact of laser beam on the propellant surface. In laser ablation in particular, we have very distinct interaction times. So imagine this process here of 1 joule per square centimeter impact happening within 1 millisecond. This yields an intensity during this process of 1 kilowatt per square centimeters. However, we have very short laser pulses of 1 microsecond. This yields to 1 megawatt per square centimeter. And we can go even further, down to 1 picosecond. This would yield 1 terawatt per centimeter in the interaction process. And that's a lot of heat energy that's raised. And just compare this with the material interaction times, for instance, for heat conduction. This might be very much energy in a very short time scale. And we can definitely expect some interesting material effects when we do so with very short laser pulses. And just for comparison, this is solar constant. It's much below those intensities. Okay, what happens in laser-induced ablation? We take a laser, we direct the laser beam to the propellant target, we focus this beam to have a very high intensity or fluence in this laser pulse. The material is heated, we have some melting, some vaporization. Vaporization means that a jet is created, which has a momentum. It can be the case with very, very, very short, so-called ultra-short laser pulses, that we have a strong shock wave, then a strong rarefaction wave, and this exceeds the ultimate tensile strength, so that we have material spallation. We might have very high intensive laser pulses where the jet is further heated up so that we have plasma formation. In any case, we will have some sort of thermal expansion, and we have momentum transfer. So we have the momentum of the jet and the momentum of the target, and this yields the momentum that we want to have in a laser ablation process. And just one note here, it might be the case that this laser is on board a satellite. We do not necessarily have this laser remote as with the laser launchers, but we can also think about a laser on board a satellite for a very small thruster. This is as well possible, and I will show you some examples of that later on. So we come back to the momentum coupling coefficient. This is imparted momentum divided by the laser energy, and what you see here is the momentum of the propellant or of the spacecraft finally. And then we have the momentum of the jet as well. So this is basic for propulsion, and this can be deduced here on the momentum conservation equation. If we do some more sophisticated modeling here, then it looks like this. We have a laser beam and a target. The target is on the right-hand side, depicted in white, and then when the density changes and gets lower, depicted in yellow. And the laser pulse is incident from the left side, and around the time of t0, and you see that the material is heated, you see some expansion, and then you see a jet formation, which is indicated in red. And this can be simulated very well. And if you like to do this on your own, just take the QR code here and access the virtual laser lab. This is a Russian tour. We have discovered this in the web and had some cooperation, and now we have the code ourselves to do these simulations. But basically you can go there and configure your lab setup and then do some laser ablation if you like. The question of what really happens in laser ablation strongly depends from the fluence that is applied. And you can see here that on the x-axis of this graph, the fluence is incorporated in this laser matter interaction parameter, which has the intensity during the laser pulse, the wavelength of the laser beam, and the duration of the laser pulse itself, the square root of this. And you have on the y-axis the momentum coupling coefficient, and there are different regimes in this graph. And let me explain what happens here. On the left side, where you have a very low fluence, this is a so-called vaporization regime. This is ruled by the fluence and the fluence threshold for laser ablation. This is a phi index 0. Because it needs a certain fluence that ablation occurs at all. Because if the fluence is too low, you will only have heating or melting or something like this. But this is material specific and wavelength specific and pulse length specific threshold of ablation for each material. Then you have the material density rho, and you have alpha as the absorptivity of the material. And you see that there's a strong rise of the momentum coupling coefficient until the maximum comes out there, and then it slowly decreases. Note that this decrease did not relate to the momentum itself, but it relates to the momentum coupling coefficient. This is the ratio of momentum divided by laser pulse energy. So the momentum itself is likely to increase continuously here, but this efficiency, which is the momentum coupling coefficient, does not. There you have a dashed line here, and there is a gray line, which denotes the ionization fraction. This line is at zero for low fluences, and then it starts to rise until you have an ionization fraction of 1. So in this transition, there is the so-called transition regime. And this transition regime goes with the ionization fraction eta index I, and it combines the momentum coupling coefficient in vaporization regime and the momentum coupling coefficient in the plasma regime. So now we have to come to the momentum coupling coefficient in plasma regime. This is here. And you can see that there's a specific function which goes with the atomic weight, A, and the degree of ionization, Z, or the, no, that's the mean ionization degree, and some sort of the laser matter interaction parameter to the power of a quarter. It's a very strange equation, and you do not have to keep this in mind, but keeping in mind would be that the momentum coupling coefficient decreases, and this decrease, this continuous decrease, can be deduced to plasma shadowing. So during the laser pulse, you have a jet that's created, and it's for very high fluences, the jet is heated and heated up more and more, and this yields to plasma formation in the jet. And during the laser pulse, this results in shadowing of the target surface. So at the end, plasma absorption yields that the target is shadowed and there's not too much laser energy left on the target surface, and so ablation goes down. This is plasma screening. If you have very short pulses, ultra-short pulses below 10 picoseconds, so the femtosecond regime, it depends a bit on the material, then this is not active. Then you have first all the laser power being absorbed and then the jet which is formated. But for longer laser pulses, and longer here means longer than 100 picosecond, you have plasma shielding for very high fluences. So let us now have a deeper look at the laser ablation process. Material is irradiated by a high power laser beam. Heat is conducted from the material surface into the deeper parts of the material, and finally melting occurs near to the surface and vaporization at the surface itself, and a plume is generated that gives recoil to the remaining target material. And if we have a look at this graphically as a temporal evolution, you can see first in orange the laser pulse, and then look at, for instance, the target itself. This is the black line. The target receives momentum correspondingly with the plume, which is the red line. And if we go in the vicinity of the target surface, there we have the momentum that is coming from recoil of the particles which are ejected there, as well as the momentum that comes from the gas pressure which is raised there itself. There are different techniques for the measurement of laser imparted momentum in the laboratory. In this experiment, the target is irradiated by a high energy laser pulse coming from the left. Subsequently, the target moves to the right. From the right hand side, it is irradiated with a low power probe laser beam, which is reflected at the target surface. Due to the Doppler effect, the frequency of the probe light increases after reflection. This increase can be measured using the superposition of the original beam and the reflected beam in an interferometer. In the high-speed recording of such an experiment, you can see the high-energy beam incident from the right-hand side now, and the probe beam coming from the left. In the photos, one can observe plasma formation, and you can see in the graph from the recorded data how laser-imparted momentum builds up over time. So these are some pictures from our lab, how we recorded the momentum. We took piezoelectric sensors, which you see at the left of this picture, denoted with an S, and we put the target just on top of the sensor. And what you see below is a graph of the signal from the piezo sensor over time. And one can take the signal and integrate over the graph and then get the momentum. And what you see is the laser beam comes from the right, denoted as L, then goes to mirror 1, mirror 2, and then from mirror 3 down to the target. And on the right-hand side, you can see what happens with those targets. In the upper pictures, you can see how they hop off from the sensor, and yes, how plasma is generated, and you see combustion as well. Let us now briefly come back to the ablation process and take a close look on what happens with metals in laser ablation. Metals consist of an iron lattice plus an electron gas. The electron gas is irradiated. Heat is distributed among the electrons. Then, after the so-called electron-phonon coupling time, heat energy goes down from the electron gas into the iron lattice. In the iron lattice, melting and vaporization takes place, and an ablation jet is formed that finally yields recoil. Depending on the material, the delay in electron-phonon coupling can amount to several tens of picoseconds. In a certain regard, the electron gas acts like a shield for the iron lattice against laser radiation. As a result, for metals, ablation takes place within a rather thin surface layer, and there's only a small amount of material that is ablated. In turn, we have high jet velocities here. We now come to the efficiencies in laser ablation. First of all, we have the so-called jet efficiency or internal propulsion efficiency. This is defined by the ratio of the reference kinetic energy of the propellant jet to the incident laser pulse energy. Reference means here that the kinetic energy refers to the average velocity of all exhausted particles. Using momentum conservation, one can express this in terms of the momentum coupling coefficient Cm and the specific impulse Isp. The physical background here is the efficiency beta of absorption of laser energy by the propellant, and subsequently the efficiency alpha of gas expansion. If one keeps the jet efficiency constant, it is visible from this graph here that one obtains a hyperbolic relationship between the impulse coupling coefficient and the specific impulse. Metals typically have a high ISP but low momentum coupling. With polymers, one has high thrust but low specific impulse. As a side note here, there's as well the jet monochromaticity, and this gives the ratio of real to reference kinetic energy. This can be used to define the ablation efficiency, and this is rather a physical figure of merit, whereas the jet efficiency is more an engineering number. Remember what we've said in photon propulsion. The efficiency of propulsion is at its best when the vehicle velocity equals the velocity of the propellant jet. Just as an idea, one could optimize a propulsion device if one adapted the velocity of the propellant to the current velocity of the space vehicle, instead of having a constant jet velocity like for conventional rockets. This concept had been proposed for laser ablative propulsion, and it looks like this. Materials like polymers, where a large amount of material is ablated, typically yield high thrust, which is needed in particular for the initial phase of a launch. On the other hand, surface absorbers like metals, or Teflon as in this example, yield low thrust but have typically a large specific impulse, which is needed in orbit. So for a laser launch, one could prepare a mixture of such materials, which overall provides for the right specific impulse at the right time of the mission. If you look at the order of magnitude, however, of the momentum coupling coefficient, you will find that it's not too much thrust that we currently can expect. Coupling is in the order of a few hundred millinewton per kilowatt laser beam power, and one can estimate that a launch from ground to low Earth orbit would demand for 1 megawatt laser power per kilogram payload. To obtain 1 megawatt laser power with high energy laser pulses is a great challenge in itself. So one might ask whether there are other applications that only require moderate laser power level. In fact, there might be some options for in-space missions where thrust does not have to be applied against the Earth's gravity field. Maybe logistic missions between satellites where laser power beaming helps to use very simple laser thrusters. Or one could think of the usage of a laser tractor beam device for sample return missions. In addition to that, laser propulsion might be usable for attitude and orbit control systems. There are different concepts of laser micropropulsion, and I want to introduce some of them to you here. First is ablation of metals with a laser, so this has to work in reflection mode because metals are surface absorber. The laser beam is directed to the surface of the metal, and in the experiment it looks like this. You have here a torsional balance, and the laser beam is coupled on this torsional balance. It's guided to a hard disk drive that is mounted on this balance, and there ablation takes place and the thrust is generated in the micronewton range typically. We have here some experimental results from the lab. You see that aluminum and gold have been tested as propellant. The momentum coupling coefficient is in the range of 10 to 100 micronewton per watt, and we have a very high specific impulse. This depends on the applied laser pulse energy, and if we look at the single impulse, then we can see that the minimum impulse bit is very, very low. It's at below 1 nanonewton times second, which is incredibly low compared with Phoebe thrusters or micro plasma pulsed thrusters. In a different concept, one can use polymers as propellant for laser propulsion. Polymers are volume absorbers, so the laser beam enters the material very deeply, and one can make use of this in a way that one takes the polymer, puts it on a layer of a transparent substrate, and irradiates it from the back through the substrate. And so the jet does not go into the direction of the laser, and there's no contamination of optics, which is quite beneficial for such a thruster. This would be a realization of this. The propellant would be mounted on a tape, and the laser irradiates the tape, and the tape is torn by a wheel, so the propellant is transported before the laser beam. And the experimental results here are that the momentum coupling coefficient might be very high. This is a polymer carbon doped, which enhances the absorption. However, the specific impulse is quite low, and so it simply depends on the application whether such a thruster with polymers would be usable or a metal thruster would be beneficial. Here as well, we have a very low impulse bit, but it's about 3 orders of magnitude higher than with metals. Imagine a space mission with very high requirements on attitude and orbit control. This might be a formation flight mission and not observation, or, for example, a scientific mission like LISA for the measurement of gravitational waves. To control the position precisely, one can have a test mass floating in a vacuum chamber on board the satellite, and then record its position in order to find out whether the surrounding satellite experiences acceleration or deceleration by residual fluctuating forces like solar wind or atmospheric drag. If it's needed to keep the satellite's position at an accuracy level of less than 1 micrometer, it would be necessary to have a microthruster with a very low thrust noise. At best, this would be a thruster without any moving components. At DLR, we have analyzed such a concept for laser-ablative microthrusters with a very low thrust noise. And here, the laser beam is positioned and is focused by electro-optical units, which can adjust focusing and positioning of the laser beam in the ablation process. So the beam is focused on the target. We have a jet generation, thrust generation. And the point here in repetitive operation is that the beam scans the target, and we do somehow laser milling so that there's a area which goes deeper and deeper, and the laser ablates this like you see here on the image. And we found that even if we do this very roughly, we already have in laser ablation a very low thrust noise. So we think that's promising to develop thrusters here if they are needed for scientific missions or something else. Apart from this, we have developed a small device for CubeSats, and this is just a demonstrator. But it shows that if we have some very simple beam steering, not electro-optical, but with mechanical devices, it would be realizable to have a thruster, which is a very compact device for thrust generation in the micro-Newton range. There are even more sophisticated concepts for the usage of laser ablation and micropropulsion. In this setup, the plasma is accelerated by an electromagnetic field. And one can consider as well thermal effects from electrical discharge to enhance the performance of a laser ablative thruster. Finally, one can even exceed the material dynamics of laser ablation when using ultra-short, high-intensity pulses together with a very thin propellant target. In this case, a so-called Coulomb explosion can take place, in which the large electric field would yield the generation of a plasma beam at relativistic jet velocities. Here we come full circle, thinking back at photon propulsion, shown at the beginning of this round trip on laser propulsion.
where the jet velocity has been the speed of light. In addition to that, there's a very special kind of space propulsion, which might become possible using high-power lasers, so hope to see you again in video number 6 on space debris propulsion.